Today we'll study Uttara Tantra Shastra. There's no class tomorrow nor day after. Monday and Tuesday next week, we will have classes on the Sutra of Great Liberation. Thursday and Friday again, Uttara Tantra Shastra. Not sure about Wednesday yet, so we'll see about the schedule for next week later. That's the first thing. And then the second thing is that in terms of the females' library that we have over here, we do have a reading section over there. I heard some of the practitioners would go there. Instead of reading books, they would also play around with their phone and with their computer and so on and so forth. For the Tibetan Jomos, in fact, they would go there and only read books because the announcement has made to them stating that if you were to stay in the reading area, you have to only read. Maybe because I haven't addressed it over here, but I am addressing it now. In the West, in lots of those large libraries, people would only stay there to read books and they have to stay very quiet. No noise shall be made. Therefore, over here, right now, if you were to read books and creating noise, you will be fined with a certain amount. That rule would be implemented. Right now, we have lots of books. Do not treat the library as a bookstore. Rather, it is a library where you can read various books. We have books right now, including the very ancient books and texts and the modern books as well. Also, we have books with various language in the English, Tibetan, Chinese, and many other languages. There are about 50,000 volumes that we have in our library. That particular number is a number of books. In fact, is considered as the most in Garzi area, in the Garzi prefecture. Some of the officials would also come here and they toured around and took a look at our library because we have the most volumes of books over here. If you come to the library, I really encourage you to just engage in reading, and we have specific area designated for reading, and there are other areas designated for example, copying and has other functions. In the reading area, the function is to read books, not to flip through your phone or computer. So you shouldn't use any of the electronics over there in the reading area. This should be implemented right now after I make this announcement. I think the majority of the practitioners are very quiet once they get into the reading area. I also encourage the staff members over here do not make loud noises when they are working. The staff members also have to abide the rules. If you were to make noises and all kinds of sounds were created by the staff members, that is not allowed either. That is not according to the rules. A library is a place that should be quiet. When I went abroad, whenever I give classes in the university and speeches in universities, I have no interest towards, for example, the shops and tourism and none of those. But I would definitely like to go to their libraries, and I visited lots of their libraries, though I can't read their books over there because I can't read their language. However, I really enjoyed staying there because of the environment and the whole atmosphere. It feels, in fact, I envy that kind of atmosphere a lot. For the practitioners, maybe many of you only want to come here and pay the Sangha to chant mantras for you, but are not interested in studying at all, then it is just like an old lady who traveled all the way to Lhasa but not seeing the Zhuo Buddha's statue. Many, I heard that they only go to the library to have pizzas rather to read books because there's a cafeteria inside the library, and they would rather travel to the cafeteria than to read books in the reading area. That is quite such a pity. Of course, if you have money and want to eat over there, I'm not saying you shouldn't do that. However, if you go there to have a meal, then at least you should stay there and read some books. Because it is a library, it's not a pizza restaurant. So let us begin the class. The unsurpassed, profound, and wonderful Dharma is difficult to encounter in billions of eons, and I'll see it, hear it, receive it, and uphold it, about to fathom the Tathagata's true meaning, to liberate all beings, less generous, supreme bodhicitta. Let's begin our class on the Uttara Tantra Shastra today. We already talked about the uncontrived and the aspect of unelaborated qualities of the Buddha. So we're talking about the 10 powers for fearlessness and 18 unmixed qualities. Out of the 32, we've already covered the 10 powers. Now let's talk about the four fearlessness. According to Asanga's commentary, in fact, he talked about the various unmixed qualities, especially he explained it according to the Dharani Autonomous King Sutra. We've quoted from this, not sutra, rather it's a chapter. It's a part of the sutra of the collective teachings. And in that chapter, in fact, it says, it talks about the four fearlessness, the 10 powers, and 18 unmixed qualities. And it was very clear. There's another translation, the Great Compassion Sutra, and within that there's a chapter also talks about the 32 types of qualities of the Buddha. But it's not as extensive. Whenever we study any sutras and shastras, we need to cross-reference to the other sutras and shastras so that we can deepen our understanding and clarify the meanings. Therefore, whenever we engage in studies, it's quite important to understand the method of study, to develop a method of study. If you do not have any books to cross-reference, if you do not have any method of study, then it would be difficult for you to generate clarity towards that text. Of course, I understand people have very limited time to engage in study, and you may feel that it's difficult to accommodate everything. Don't even mention about looking into other texts. In fact, people feel that they don't even have time to sleep nor eat. And cross-referencing seems like a far-fetched dream for those people who don't have time. However, I'm just bringing into your attention that it is important to cross-reference to the other sutras and shastras so that you can develop a clarity to the teachings. Today we're looking at the four fearlessness, and over here it talks about its the essence and the function. Let's look at the essence. There are the two types. In terms of the essence, there are the two aspects, that is the function and the essence, and then there is an elaboration on top of this with a metaphor in the later part. So the four fearlessness, let's look at the essence of it. In fact, this is also taught in the other sutras and shastras. For example, the year before, before last year, during our classes on the ornament of the Mahayana Sutra Shastra, there is one verse that talks about how the Buddha has the fearlessness of a perfect enlightenment, of overcoming any obstacles, as well as expounding the path and fearlessness of cessation. So those were also taught in that verse. But let's look at how it's expounded in Uttara Tantra Shastra. Over here it says that perfectly enlightening all phenomena, setting an end to all hindrances, teaching the path and showing cessation are the four aspects of fearlessness. Previously, the ten powers refers to the ten powers derived from wisdom, or the wisdom powers. And over here, the four fearlessness shows a sense of fearlessness of mind. Rather, it is not the fearlessness in the way saying that someone is violently fearless in terms of physical presence. It is a fearlessness of mind. So the Buddha, in fact, do not have any fear, cowardice towards any phenomena. The first one is that the fearlessness of perfect enlightenment. Second one is fearlessness of setting to an end of all hindrances. And third one is fearlessness of teaching the path. And fourth one is fearlessness of showing cessation. Let's look at the first one. So on the path of training, Buddha have taught the Dharma without greed and avarice, but he was guided by a calm and impartial mind. He was of great impartiality and great equanimity when he was giving teachings to the sentient beings with the correct Dharma. For this reason, no opponent can defeat their sacred words when they say, I am directly and perfectly enlightened within the sphere of all phenomena, proclaiming this to the best possible realization and benefit for self. In fact, he would proclaim that I have already attained perfect enlightenment, I am omniscient, and I have acquired all the wisdom. So he proclaimed it without any fear. But the disciples nowadays, in fact, none of us can proclaim that, such as their disciples would approach me and tell me that, oh, I am so ashamed and I'm so embarrassed to tell you that I've only studied so-and-so and I haven't really generated much wisdom. And whenever I ask them what classes are you taking, they would say, oh, I'm from the Madhyamika class, but I'm afraid I'm not very good at those classes and I'm so embarrassed. So people would generate such kind of embarrassment and fear, but the Buddha is completely different. He is fearless, and the reason is because he had taught Dharma with the impartiality. The second aspect is that it's because the Buddhas have not relied on adverse phenomena. They had not relied on any obstacles or adverse situations at all. Therefore, no one whoever can contest them when they state, set an end to attachment and so forth, the hindrances to liberation, teaching this to the impediments to the benefit of the others. There is no fear for the Buddha to teach the sentient beings to set an end to all hindrances, let it be afflictions of the root afflictions or of all the other branch afflictions, the three poisons, and so on and so forth. In fact, whenever it is for us to state that, well, you can put in a stop to the hindrances to afflictions, even if we can expound such teachings to the others, there may be people might come forth and say that, oh, you can only pay lip service to these teachings, but look at yourself, you have not eradicated any of those afflictions yet. People would laugh at you because you have not eradicated all of those afflictions and adverse phenomena yet yourself. Therefore, at the time of expounding such kind of teachings to the others by a mundane being like us, it would be quite fearful because we'll be challenged. And then the third one is that they have kept to the path of all the virtuous. In the causal stage, the Buddha had led the path and as well as kept the path of all the virtuous phenomena. Therefore, he has no fear to expound any of those yanas, any of those paths of the three paths to the sentient beings. Sometimes whenever the ordinary beings want to give teachings of the various paths, various teachings according to various paths, we would say that, oh, according to Nagarjuna, he would state this, and according to so-and-so master, he would say that. As an ordinary being, in fact, we do not have the kind of confidence to expound the Dharma and teach the path in accordance, in the perfect accordance to the audience. So when it comes to the giving the teaching of the path, The Buddha gave the teachings of how to be liberated from the three existence according to the three different yanas. So this is the third one, and the fourth one is cessation. Since the Buddha taught the Dharma without any pride during the causal stage, he did not have any arrogance at all when he was expounding the Dharma. So from his personal aspect, from the self-benefit aspect, he had already eradicated all that is to be eradicated. Therefore, he can expound the teachings of cessation without any fear. The first and fourth one are taught from the benefiting of self aspect, and the second and the third one, fearlessness, are taught from benefiting others. When it comes to the teaching of the Four Noble Truths, the ordinary beings would come forth and start to debate to the Buddha, especially the Shramanas engaged in a great deal of asceticism. Or the Brahmins whom generated a great deal of arrogance because they have different deportments, or the kinds of Shravaka or the kinds of Brahmas generated great arrogance because of their merits. In fact, the Buddha does not have any of those arrogance. The ordinary beings, without knowing the merit and wisdom of the Buddha, they would slander the Buddha. In fact, not only during the Buddha's time, there would be such voices of criticism towards the Buddha. Even during today, there are lots of voices to criticize the Buddha.
So, the
Shramanas, celestial beings, Brahmins,
and
celestial beings, Maras and Brahmas, they would definitely not be able to compete with the qualities and merits of the Buddha, because the Buddha's qualities, especially in terms of fearlessness, the Buddha is of great fearlessness, just like the lion. From a Buddhist point of view, of course, we would praise the Buddha like such. How about the other religions? The other religions would also claim that their teachers or their mentors are exactly the same. They're of greatness. However, for myself, I think out of our faith and out of our understanding and wisdom, we can expound to the others on how great the Buddha is. But according to a traditional saying, we say that whenever we were to say anything good about the others, any excellent qualities about the others, in fact, the other people around, the other audience, would start to try to pick the faults of that particular person. But if you were to saying the otherwise, then people would start to come out and talk about the good qualities. However, if the teachers or mentors of the various religion, if they were to harbor any faults, then you can definitely point them out. If that is the truth. I think lots of people nowadays, whenever we talk about the 18 MX qualities and 10 powers and the 4 fearlessness, the Buddhists, in fact, on one hand, they feel that they're Buddhists, therefore they shouldn't say the otherwise. And on the other hand, maybe because of the lack of wisdom, they dare not to debate upon all these special qualities of the Buddha. But when we look at the various qualities of the Buddha, especially when we talk about the different qualities with flowery words, we can talk about all the various qualities of the Buddha with all the most beautiful flowery words. But if you do not develop a very steady belief based on the understanding, then your mind would be easily wavered by the other religions as well, by the other philosophies. For example, your mind could be wavered because you hear that others say Christianity is wonderful and so on and so forth. If you were to be wavered by those kinds of proclamations, then you are, it really is a sign that you have not developed any certainty in your own religion yet. For Buddhist practitioners, let you be engaged in any schools of Buddhism. If you can delve into the profundity of that particular school or in Buddhism, then you will be more focused and you have, you can develop more of a steady mind, and your mind won't waver like the grass sitting on the top of a wall. So we have to use our wisdom to make such observation for ourselves and come to the conclusion by yourself that the Buddha is indeed of the greatest in this world. According to the essay on the meaning of Mahayana, it says that because the mind of wisdom is of no fear, therefore he is named as fearless. And I think according to the Madhyamikavatara, where it says that the nature, because of the nature of the four fearlessness is inherent, is harbored, therefore the mind of the Buddha is of great steadfast. According to the Agama Sutra, there are the various questions and answers from between the Buddha and the heretics. For example, the heretics once asked, some of the wordings that you've used may not be all pervasively correct. For example, if you know that this is going to, if you know that the other person travels so and so forth, In fact, if you were to know everything, then how come that you do not know where this person comes from? And if you do not know that, then you cannot call yourself as omniscient. There are the kinds of questions and answers expounded in the sutras, and then the Buddha's reply was that it does not apply to the truth. Such kind of questions do not apply to the understanding of truth, therefore it does not need to be answered. And the Buddha would speak of the gentle language to Ananda, and when it comes to conversing with Devadatta, the Buddha would scold him. So there are the various speeches that's used to communicate with the different disciples of different capacities, but is it because the Buddha has certain preference or afflictions? In fact, to Rahula and the other disciples, the Buddha expounded with the language of gentleness and loving kindness is because the Buddha really expounds this to the sentient beings who needs this kind of language, and vice versa. Sometimes the Buddha would say that they are my disciples. And by proclaiming that these group of disciples are considered as the Buddha's disciples, it is not to say that the Buddha generated grasping towards them. Rather, it is because of the causes and the conditions that has already matured. Therefore, the Buddha proclaims so. People have various confusions, and out of those kinds of questions and answers, it could definitely eradicate those confusions. Some other sutras also talks about when it comes to obscuration, though the Buddha has taught the various ways of working with afflictions, taught the Dharma upon those. However, the disciples of the Buddha cannot eradicate their afflictions by after hearing the Dharma. What's the reason behind that? If the Buddha is omniscient, then the disciples should be able to. And if the Buddha is omnipotent, then the disciples should be able to. However, the Buddha's teaching is of the truth and is according to the truth. However, the disciples' practice and their faculty and capacity is not up to par to uphold those teachings and eradicate their afflictions. Nor they do not engage in the practice of it.
实际上呢，就是佛陀的这个法呢，就是可以论证悟的。
But the Buddha's teaching, the Dharma, can lead to liberation. However, certain disciples' practice is not sufficient to lead them to enlightenment. Just like medicine, there are medicines that has the function of healing. However, if the patient do not take those medicines to the certain amount, to the required amount, then of course the medicine won't work. Similarly, if the disciples cannot engage in enough practice, then they cannot attain liberation or cannot attain certain fruition. People would ask, are there things that the Buddha is considered as incapable or as fearful? According to the mundane being's perception, they may feel that the Buddha's teaching also include some of it also include adversity or include obscurations.
If
In fact, even after the Buddha expounded the perfect Dharma, the disciples have already created auspicious coincidence with the Buddha, then they will be able to be crossed over. But the ones who do not have auspicious connections to the Buddha, then they would not be able to be crossed over by the Dharma teaching of liberation. Look at lots of the disciples are different students. Many of the students, they generate great faith towards the tutors, but not the Dharma teachers. And the hierarchy usually is the Dharma teachers would cultivate a few of the Dharma tutors, and then there are students who only generated a good relation with the Dharma tutors, but not the Dharma teacher, and would view the Dharma tutors as their Vajra teacher, and then the Dharma teacher would feel that they are would feel quite befuddled, and sometimes feel this kind of situation is this kind of situation is rather quite rare. There are people, of course, it is because that people have different faculties and different capacities and different aspirations. The different aspirations would lead to the various preferences in their way of listening to the Dharma. For example, they're the ones who enjoys the teaching that's taught from a very logical way, and that they are the ones prefer the other way around. So the teachings nowadays as given by the Dharma teachers should be given in accordance with the previous lofty masters at the same time that is in accordance with the modern time. And I really feel that the majority of the Dharma teachers are doing very well in that way. However, it also depends on the faculty and the wishes of the disciples as well. According to the biography of the two noble ones and the six adornments, and according to their biography, we can see how the disciples receive teachings in various ways. But majority of the disciples definitely do and could gain a transformation of their mind stream. Whenever I listen to some of the teachings from the others, sometimes I don't understand what they were talking about, but maybe they're very good at it too, because there are people who understand their teaching. And sometimes I see that there are disciples at the time of giving oral presentation upon the Dharma, they get very, very enthusiastic and sometimes very nervous and excited at the same time, and they couldn't really speak much. However, whenever I listen to your oral presentation after the class, I do get inspired from your take of the class as well. Anyhow, since we have this opportunity of engage in listening and contemplation, we should cherish this opportunity, as I stated last time. From last class, I've mentioned this. Maybe later on, when you don't have this opportunity, and when you look back at the period of time that you engage in the study of Dharma, you would generate a sense, a very different sense of feeling, and you would probably cherish this opportunity more and cherish this memory more. Whenever we read into the sutras and whenever we study such kind of qualities of the Buddha, who is definitely very unusual and unique, we should generate a sense of joy. For the sentient beings without much of a steadfast view, it would be difficult for them to study with great profundity. Rather, they would waver according to the different teachings. And now, the function and how the Four Noble Truths would be taught in accordance to the Four Fearlessness. Many would wonder, what's the difference between a worldly hero and the fearless Buddha? Is there any difference? Of course, let's look at the Four Noble Truths that's taught by the Buddha. The Four Fearlessness are taught in the way from benefiting self and benefiting the others. And now knowing and causing others to know all different aspects of things that are to be known of oneself and the others. This points to the truth of suffering, that all should generate understanding and recognition of it. And then, the truth of suffering should be known. That's the first aspect. And the second aspect is that to expound the teaching of the Noble of Truth to the beings with auspicious connections. So you have to know that it is of suffering within the three realms, the nature of the three realms of suffering. By expounding this, in fact, the Buddha has no fear when it comes to expounding the truth of suffering. And then the second aspect is that the Buddha said that I have abandoned the cause of the accumulation of suffering. By expounding that such truth, the Buddha does not have any fear either, while expounding such truth. While expounding the practice aspect, the Buddha does not have any fear either. But for the ordinary practitioners, we have all kinds of questions. Oh, am I practicing this wrong? Am I on the wrong path? Have I tread on the wrong path? So on and so forth. But the Buddha expounds on the practice and the path of practice without any fear. And then the last one is that the Buddha proclaimed that I have already attained the supreme fruition of pacifying, of the two purified, the two pacified, that is of the cessation. So the Buddha, having attained and causing attainment of the peerless and stainless to be attained, they relate to their own truth, the own truth to the others, that the great sages are unhindered anywhere. The great sage over here refers to the Buddha. According to many of the sutras, they would address the Buddha by saying that he is the great sage. So this great sage, that is the Buddha, does not have any obscurations nor hindrances. If we were to be very good at studying and contemplation in your own practice, then you would not be fearful. Whenever you give oral presentations in front of the whole Sangha or give presentations and speech to the other crowds, any of the other worldly crowds as well as in universities, you would not generate any fear if you generate understanding to the shastras and sutras. When it comes to, for example, sometimes the numbers and detailed aspect, even if you don't generate the profound understanding, but if you were to generate the profound understanding of the four fearlessness, you would be able to expound the Dharma without any fear. We ourselves have to expound the teachings of the Four Noble Truths. We have to generate profound understanding
and
be capable of expounding the Four Noble Truths to the others. In fact, the Four Noble Truths, the teaching of such, is recognized not only in Buddhism but it is recognized and taught in various schools as well. And now, with the metaphor, let's look at how this example could further explain and clarify the fearlessness. It says that the Lord of Animals is ever fearless to the far ends of the jungle, undoubtedly roaming among the other animals. In any assembly, the Lord of Munis is a lion as well, remaining at ease, independent, stable, and endowed with skill. So the lion, abides at the far ends of the jungle, and the far ends of the jungle doesn't necessarily mean that they are just at the corners. Rather, it means that they stay at a secluded area, such as snow mountains and so on. But the lions, though abiding in secluded areas, and maybe even if they were to stay within all the other beasts and tigers and elephants and so on, they still would be able to abide with great ease. Similarly,
the Buddha,
while abiding in the crowd, in the crowds of the arrogant people or any kinds of people, the Buddha would be able to abide with a sense of ease. Nowadays, people feel that they do not have the ability to be independent without the help from their parents, without the help from their close ones. They feel that they are not able to be independent at all. They need the help from the others, but the Buddha is of complete steadfast and independence.
The Buddha's
power is of the
什么如来不共, 如续共能者, 什么无耳如岁月, 是吧? 就前面有这个,
the Buddha's power is like the Vajra, and the Buddha's all pervasiveness is like the space, and the Buddha's fearlessness is like the lion. And the Buddha, therefore, can be called the lion of all beings, of all humans. And the Buddha can be called as the mentor and teacher of all beings. Why is that? There are the four qualities. The first one is to remain at ease, independent, stable, and endowed with skill.
就是这种这个佛陀的这个庄严和佛陀的这种这个
the adornment and the unmixed qualities of the Buddha
这个群体当中呢就是很难以这个跟他这个相提并论啊
it's very unique among all kinds of communities and groups. I believe according to Ekogama Sutra, it says, in fact, there is a story, story of Nirgrantha, who is a heretic, a non-Buddhist believer. At that time, he took 500 of his disciples to debate with the Buddha.
他的那些眷属呢，就是说是，我今天呢，就是一定要就是把这个去天去探萨门呢，就是。
And he stated that today I am.
就是战胜
Today we're here to debate with the Buddha.
恐惧啊，就是羞耻啊，就是出这个出汗呐，就是等等，就是一定要做。
And we're here to debate with the Buddha so that the Buddha would be feared by our teaching, and the Buddha would even perspirate and get very nervous in front of our teachings. So this heretic Nirgrantha came in front of the Buddha and started to debate with the Buddha by saying that I say that all phenomena are permanent. What do you think? And then the Buddha replied by saying that I say that all phenomena are of impermanence and it is selfless as well. It is of the nature of selfless. Then Nirgrantha continued to say that, but then all phenomena is of permanence. And then the Buddha said that, well, in that case, if you think it's permanence, then could you say that a Chakravartin is of great freedom within his country of reigning? And then Nirgrantha replied by saying that, of course, the Chakravarti has such freedom and power. And then the Buddha continued to say that
do
the Chakravartins also get old, get aged, get gray-haired, and get wrinkled? And then Nirgrantha remained silent because he couldn't reply that question. He couldn't say yes or no. Then the Buddha asked him three times, and he didn't reply for three times. And at that time, Gihārpāda Vajra appeared in the sky, in the space, and then addressed Nirgrantha. Appeared in front of Nirgrantha, saying that, well, if you do not reply to the Buddha, I shall split your head into seven pieces. And then the world northern one told Nirgrantha by saying that the Chakravartin would also get old, their hair would be grayed, and their tooth would be fallen, and skin would be wrinkled. And then the Buddha, and then Nyingrahta said that's true. The Chakravartins, even Chakravartins would get aged. The Buddha then said that, well, isn't that contradicting to what you've said? If Chakravartins, who is of great power, would get aged, and if they're not of permanence, then how could you say that all phenomena is of the quality of permanence? And then Nyingrahta kept silent, and he started to perspirate out of nervousness. The Buddha then said that, well, when you came here, you had the intention of making me sweat out of nervousness, but look at who's sweating right now. We can see from this story that the Buddha had lots of debates like such with the other non-Buddhist believers. And his teachings and his debates were derived from the teachings of the Four Noble Truths. In fact, even nowadays, if we were
其他的有一些的话呢，就是也不是特别的重要，就是最关键的佛陀里面，佛陀这个所讲到的这个四法印上面，就是。If
we were to look at the different teachings of the Buddha, the core of such teachings is the Four Noble Truths. Therefore, we need to engage in study and generate great understanding of the Four Noble Truths. So, in the Four Fearlessness, in fact, it talks about the Four Fearlessness of that derived from the wisdom. And then let's look at the 18 unmixed features. There are the concise explanation and the function. So let's look at the concise explanation of the essence. And the 18 unmixed features can be divided into four aspects as well. So let's look at the first of the four aspects. It says that there is no delusion, no idle talk. The teacher's mindfulness is unimpaired. Never is his mind not resting evenly. There is no harboring of various ideas. There is no equanimity without analysis. So the Buddha, in fact, has the 18 unmixed qualities, and the first aspect out of the four categories is on no delusion.
佛陀这个称佛一合的话呢，他根本没有在他的身体的行为上呢，就是什么这个。This
is the first aspect, the first category of that is the six qualities pertain to physical conduct. The first one is as far as his physical behavior is concerned, there is no delusion. The physical body of the Buddha appears at all times to be extremely appropriate, unlike some of the other disciples whom would skip around just like a monkey, and the other disciples whom may speak out with extremely loud voice. The Buddha's body is of great fitting to whatever situation, and his actions would lead to people's generation of faith towards him. Whatever he does, whatever his movement, and even his attire is very different than those of the others, according to the media. The Madhyama Agama, where it says that the Buddha's clothing is ever constant a little bit apart from the body of the Buddha, and the clothing would not be scattered and blown up by the wind, and the clothing of the Buddha is like such, and the shadow of the Buddha could provide comfort and refuge to other beings. The vicious beasts, vicious dogs and elephants would be encountered by the kind of disciple, the kind of people with such kind of karmic connection, but the Buddha would never encounter any animal with a vicious nature or with such kind of viciousness. The Mara, in fact, spent 6 years to seek the shortcomings of the Buddha, but couldn't find any. The Mara, in fact, is very powerful. So think about it, if the Mara were to follow the Buddha for 6 years and couldn't find the shortcoming of the Buddha. In the Vinaya teachings, it says that the six heretics teachers followed the Buddha and want to seek for the opportunity to compete with him. But they went there, and upon seeing the beautiful appearance, magnificent appearance, of the Buddha, then the heretics said that there's nothing I can find faulty on the physical presence of the Buddha, and they did not want to compete with the Buddha. And then they tried to send another person to find the shortcoming and then to challenge the Buddha, but they couldn't find it either. So the six heretics teachers had to give up. That's the first aspect. And the second aspect of the conduct is that as far as his verbal behavior is concerned, there is no idle talk. The Buddha does not have any speech that would be harmful and it would not generate any argument or would not be the speech of lies and would not generate any quarrels or frivolous speech. So that's the uncommon quality of the speech. And then the Buddha, upon practicing the six right mindfulness, the six mindfulness including right mindfulness of remembering the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha, and so on. Upon such kind of causes that's accumulated by the Buddha does not forget. Unlike nowadays, I think many people would say that, oh, I have terrible memory, and I can't remember whatever happened before. It is probably because of your faculty. On top of that, it could be related to food as well, or it could be because a lack of chanting of Manjushri mantra. We can see that people definitely have very different capacities of memory. Not sure the reason though. And then the fourth one talks about how his mind is never such that it does not rest evenly in meditative equipoise. Because the Buddha had protected the mind of the others, therefore the Buddha is constantly abiding at ease and do not have any distractions. The arhats can use their miraculous power when they are in samadhi. However, the Buddhas, even during the post-meditation, they still can use their his miraculous powers and they can engage in various kinds of actions. According to the Maharanakuta Sutra, where it says that the sentient beings would not be able to know the sphere of experience of the Tathagata, because the Tathagata is constantly abiding in samadhi. Such kind of emancipation is inconceivable. Since the Buddha has already eradicated all kinds of wrong views. So there is no dualistic thoughts. There's no various ideations generated from all kinds of phenomena. The mundane beings, in fact, generates all kinds of variations of elaborations, and they generate thoughts that would lead to being oversensitive and anxiety, and some people couldn't fall asleep at night. Many people, in fact, they have to take pills to sleep pills to sleep. That's the only method for them to fall asleep. Some of the authorities I know, they would think about various things, and because of that, they can't fall asleep, and they would require their employees to keep their cell phone on so that they can, the authorities can call them at all times to solve those problems. But the Buddha is very different. The Buddha don't have any kinds of conceptual elaborations like such. In fact, not only those conceptual elaborations, the Buddha do not even have any differentiation, would not generate any differentiation of the ideation of the samsara and nirvana. So whenever we look at ordinary beings, indeed we would generate a sense of pity. Whatever the ordinary beings would act, those actions would not bring much benefit to self nor the others. But look at the Buddha. The Buddha does not grasp onto the different entity of nirvana and samsara. So since there's no variation of elaborations, the Buddha is of great equanimity as such. And that leads to the sixth one. Because the Buddha had practiced great equanimity, so the Buddha knows when the sentient beings have already matured in terms of their faculty and timing, then the Buddha would come to liberate and cross them over. Unlike the ordinary beings and the bodhisattvas, as well as arhats, they do not see the capacity of the sentient beings. But the Buddha knows all the capacities of the sentient beings, and then the Buddha would act out in accordance to the capacity of sentient beings. And the Buddha's actions the Buddha would constantly adjust the action according to the adjustment and changes of the capacity of the sentient beings. For example, according to the sutra, when it says that when the disciple generated a sense of aversion towards the Buddha, then the Buddha would part from the disciples and start giving teachings in the celestial realm. And once the disciples started to miss the Buddha and thinking that, oh, why is the Buddha still away, then the Buddha would get back and start to expound the teachings again. Sometimes if the Buddhas were to be there, or some of the great masters were to abide at one place for too long, then the disciples would not understand the preciousness of such great master. Therefore, the Buddha, once seeing the different changes of the disciples' mind, the Buddha would then adjust the action or to part for a little while. So we can see that the Buddha definitely would carry out the actions in accordance to the various capacities of sentient beings. We can see that there are the various unmixed qualities of the Buddha. So we should stop here today.
Chubum tsunin dhova dhura.